you've been with us, we've been in the book of Philippians. This is week 10, if you're keeping track. And we've been talking about, for 10 weeks, about how God wants to bring forth joy in our lives. Because the reality is, life's not always filled with kicks and giggles, amen? And yet, it's in the midst of the journey that we find the joy that God desires for us to have. And here of late, Paul's been encouraging the Philippians, encouraging us. What, last week it was be one with Christ, that we would become one with Him, that we would be unified with Him. And this idea that Paul says, hey, and the good news is, he says, for us, is he says, I'm not there yet. I'm seeking that, but what happened? He said, I want to press on. I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep searching for that which Christ has laid out for me, that I might walk in the fullness of that. And now we come to chapter 4, and Paul's wrapping up the letter. We got today and next Sunday, and we'll be finished with this very short epistle. And Paul has some final words for them. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 1, it says, therefore, I always love a therefore, therefore, in light of everything I just said, in light of the first three chapters, therefore, my beloved brethren, whom I long to see, my joy and my crown. What Paul calls the folks in Philippians, in Philippi. First of all, he says what? He says, you're my beloved brethren, my beloved brothers. Now, we've been hitting that word beloved over and over again, agapitos, right? And it means highly favored, you know, deep love, this deep affection that he has. And Paul says, hey, I want you to know, Paul dearly loved them, and they dearly loved Paul, and they had a deep love for one another. You know, and I want us to understand that if we're going to press into the journey God has before us, you know, loving God and loving others is a critical piece. Amen? We have to love one another. You say, well, why is love so critical? Well, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13 says this, until then, until when? Until Jesus comes, amen? Come on. Until this age ends, there are three things that remain, faith, hope, and love, yet love surpasses them all, so above all else. Man, I love that phrase. Above all else. Above all else. Above absolutely everything else, what? Let love be the beautiful prize for which you run. Let love be the thing that we're majored on. Love for God, love for one another. 1 Peter 4, it says, above all, verse 8, above all, constantly echo God's intense love for one another, for love will be a canopy over a multitude of sins. The Bible's absolutely clear. It's love. We need to be engaged in the love that God has for us. You know, what's that look like? Now, I want to suggest that for most of us, myself included, I don't believe any of us in this room today fully have come to understand how much God really loved. Well, he died for me. Yes, he died for you. But remember what it says in John 15, 9. What? That Jesus loves you with the same love that the Father has for him. Amen. Come on. When God looks at you, he loves you. And listen, Jesus loves you with the same love that God had for him. You know, John 17, 23 says that the Father loves you with the same love he loved the Son. Now think about that. Come on. How much does the Father love Jesus? Is there anything that he would withhold from his Son? And yet Scripture says God loves you exactly the same way. And you say, well, I know God loves me. I want you to understand, we don't understand how much, we really don't believe that. We don't believe that he loves us the same way he loves Jesus. And yet that's exactly what Scripture says. That we've been created in his image. See, we have to understand that love is the greatest thing of all. The focus, Jesus summarized it, what? Love God, love your neighbor, amen? Love one another. That love is the currency of heaven's kingdom. And listen, in this series, you know, we've been talking about how joy is released, and joy, we experience joy. Watch this now. when we know we're deeply loved by God, all hell can be breaking loose, but I know I am deeply loved by the Father. And watch this now, not just we have this love, we experience this love, we experience the horizontal love by others. Joy is released in our lives. See, God's desire is for all of us that we would have that kind of love atmosphere in which we're living in. That we would come back. And I want you to understand. You know, I hear people say all the time, well, Billy just gets his butt to church, he'd be better. Come on. Coming in here and sitting in this room does not equal love. Doesn't equal relationship, doesn't equal love with God, doesn't equal love with one another. You can come in here and sit in these pews and get up and go and never really develop a level of love and relationship with one another that he's talking about. See, coming to church is not what he's talking about. He said, I want you to build a community, a family where together we love God, and out of that, what? We have deep love for one another. That we have this love for each other. You know, we see it in the book of Acts. You know, people were like, you know, they always want to kind of poo-poo that. Well, that was just the beginning of the church. But look what it says, Acts 2, verse 42. It says, every believer, say every believer. Not just some, every believer was faithfully devoted to following the teachings of the apostle, the word of God. Their hearts were mutually linked to one another. Come on, mutually linked is not, hey, Lynn, come on, hey. He's got a little, yeah. That's not mutually linked, right? Mutually linked is we're interlocked in arms with one another, doing life together. Watch this now. Mutually linked to one another, sharing communion and coming together regularly for prayer. Verse 43, a deep sense of holy awe swept over everyone, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. Verse 44, and all the believers, there they are again, were in fellowship as one body, koinonia. They were doing life together, and they shared with one another whatever they had. Verse 45, out of generosity, they even sold their assets to distribute the proceeds to those who were in need among them. And daily they met together in the temple courts in one another's homes to celebrate communion. They shared meals together with joyful hearts and tender humility. They were continually filled with praises of God and enjoying the favor of all the people. What's that look like? See, they were what? Loving one another. They saw themselves as a family that would take care of one another. And I want to suggest we got to have that kind of love. We have to have that level of love. Now, for most of us, we hope that we have that maybe in our marriage or in our families or we receive that in other ways. Amen? You know, we experience that depth of love, but the reality is there's a whole lot of people who aren't getting that level of love out there. Amen? In fact, we got a whole world that is missing out on love because they don't understand what true love is because they're not experiencing it out there. But listen, when they encounter this group of people, they ought to encounter a love fest that comes because of the relationship that we have with one another. See, that's the picture Paul's painting. He says, that's the relationship that the Philippians have. That's the relationship he has with the Philippians. They're a family. Now, what happens in genuine family when there's a need? Come on, somebody help me. What happens, Kenny? You're shaking your head over there. You got to help them. And help is not, hey, brother, I'll pray for you. See, in real family, in genuine family, when there's a need, family shows up. Amen. Come on, family doesn't phone it in. Family shows up. And what? They come into the life and they care for one another. They take care of one another and they meet the needs of one another. Family takes care of family. You know, Brenda and I have been so incredibly blessed these last 3 months. You know, I was in the hospital for a week and, you know, we get home and people bring us food. You know, they won't let me get on the mower. And, you know, somebody comes over and mows my yard on my mower. Then my mower gets sick. And, you know, all of a sudden the next week they load up a trailer with a couple of mowers on. And they come over and mow my grass. And then they come back and do it again. You know, taking care of my grass. Why? You know, doing other things. Lots of you have offered to help. And listen, we're not done. We're going to get moved one of these days. We're going to need some real help. Right? So don't think that if you haven't got to ask yet, don't. It's okay. You got plenty of opportunities left. But here's the deal. What? You have loved on us by showing up Amen? And that's what love does. That's what love looks like. Love is a verb. We use love like it's some kind of noun. Well, I love you. Ray comes sometimes. He says to me every time I see him, he says, I love you. Okay, love's a noun, but listen, true love's a verb. There's action behind true love, and Paul calling out to them. But notice what else he says about this group of people. Therefore, my beloved brethren, whom I long to see, my joy and my crown. Man, I love that. He's talking about them. He said, man, you guys are my joy. Now, what's that word joy? That joy word means a settled state of contentment, confidence, and hope. Paul's like, man, I am so content and satisfied with the way you're chasing after Jesus. I'm confident you're going to keep going after Jesus. I'm filled with hope that you're going to walk in the fullness of who God's created to be. Man, I am so joyful when I think about you. Woo! Man, that's awesome, isn't it? Paul says, hey, when I think about you, man, he says, when my week's going bad, he says, when things are not good, he said, all I got to do is start thinking about you, because when I think about you, my heart is filled with joy. He started the letter that way. He says, I want you to know you're my joy, but he says also, you're my crown. Come on. My crown. That word crown, Stephanos, means garland or honor or glory. It's the wreath that they passed out in the ancient games, put on the heads of the victor. Now, it's the same word Paul uses in 1 Timothy 4. When he writes to Timothy, he says this, and now the time is fast approaching for my release from this life, and I've already been offered as a sacrifice. I have fought an excellent fight, and I've finished my full course with all my might, and I've kept a heart full of faith. But notice this, and there's a crown, Stephanos, of righteousness, awaiting in heaven for me, and I know that the Lord will reward me on that day of righteous judgment. And this crown is not only waiting for me, but all those who long love and long for his unveiling. Man, how many of you are thinking about that day? Amen. Come on, there's coming a day, right? You're going to finish, and they're standing at the finish line will be Jesus with the crown of righteousness. You already have his righteousness, but the full reward of the righteousness he's given you will come on that day. He's going to place it on your head. What a powerful picture. And Paul's saying, man, when I think about you, he says, you're my crowning glory. You're my victory, the accomplishments. See, when Paul looks at them that way, he's looking at his sons and daughters, and he's like, wow. They are my joy. I love Proverbs 17. Now I'm a grandpa. Proverbs 17:6 says this, grandparents have the crowning glory of life, grandchildren. Amen. Come on, what happens with grandkids? Come on, parents, come on. What happens is when you're raising your kids, you're in the battle, right? And you don't get to see it quite as much. But when you have grandkids, you get to look and say, come on, look what happens. Look at the fruit of what's taken place in all those years of faithfulness. You know, these grandkids, man, they're awesome, and we love our kids, and man, look what's happening in their lives, and all these beautiful things. Paul looked at his spiritual sons and daughters, his grandchildren. He felt the same way. He said, man, I poured into you, I loved on you, I nurtured you, I corrected you, I cared about you, but man, now you are such a joy when I think about you, and a crown when I get to talk about you to other people. Man, look what God's done. Amen? That's how Paul saw the Philippians. That's the relationship he had with them. And God wants us to create that level of love and relationship with one another. That as we look at one another, as we raise up sons and daughters, spiritual sons and daughters and grandchildren, that we look at them and we take great joy. I've told you before, one of the greatest joys in my life is when I watch someone I've had the opportunity to pour into take that and run and become what God's want them to be. Man, I just get so excited to watch them go. Why? It's like, and it's not an arrogant thing, it's just like, there's just a joy and an excitement in my heart. Amen? You know what that's like when you think about your kids or your grandkids. What a powerful picture. And that's what Paul desires. But notice what it says. He goes on, therefore, my beloved brethren, whom I long to see, my joy, my crown, in this way stand firm in the Lord, my beloved. Now, I love this. Paul gets a double beloved in that verse. He starts with the beloved and ends with the beloved. Listen, they are dearly loved. Amen? Amen. Amen. But notice what Paul says. He says, I want you to keep living. He says, I want to give you some keys to continue to stand firm in what? Pressing forward into all that Christ has for you. And standing firm, truth number one is this. You ready? Maintaining unity. Verse 2 says, and I urge Eudodia, and I urge Susan. I cannot pronounce this next name, so we'll call her Susan. All right? Urge those to live in harmony in the Lord. Indeed, true companions, I ask you also to help these women who have shared in my struggle in the cause of the gospel together with Clement also and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. So Paul's beginning to write. He begins to point out that there's an issue going on in the church, that there's something that is threatening their unity. And Paul mentions that there are two women who have a disagreement. They have an argument, whatever it might be. They're not seeing eye to eye. They're at odds with one another. Now, I want you to notice two things he says about these women, all right? Number one, what's he say? He calls them by name. Paul knows them. These aren't just a couple random women in the church. These are women that he has known. And in fact, he goes on and says, they have shared in my struggle. They've helped me proclaim the gospel in Philippi. Their names are in the book of life. He's saying, hey, here are a couple women. Now, many believe that these women probably were with Lydia at the river when Paul comes in Acts 16 to Philippi the first time. They're down having prayer meeting. Paul shares the gospel and they encounter Jesus. And having encountered Jesus, then they do what? Then they begin to walk with Paul, walk with Jesus, begin to help Paul proclaim the gospel, help fund the ministry, help do a lot of things in order for the church of Philippi to become a reality, to raise up sons and daughters of the king. And I want you to understand that these just aren't some random women, but they have served well. They're two pillars in the church. They are matriarchs, if you will, in the life of the church. And now they don't see eye to eye. Now, we don't know what was going on. Maybe it was a personal issue. You know, maybe one of them stole the recipe, somebody's recipe for the pie, I don't know. Or maybe it was more of a community issue or a political issue or a scriptural issue, a church issue. But whatever it was, guess what? Their disagreement was threatening not only their unity, threatening the unity in the church. It was becoming an issue, and you know how that happens. You know what happens, right? You know, someone gets their feelings hurt. Or someone disagrees with a decision someone else made, or we get upset with the pastor, or disagree with the decision of the church, or how we're going to spend some money. You know, don't like this, don't like that. And what happens? A disagreement comes, right? And what happens if that disagreement doesn't get settled, if we don't get past that, eventually what happens is what? People start taking sides, right? Well, part of the church, right, try the family agrees with Sally, and the other part agrees with Susan. And then there's a third group who's trying to make peace between Sally and Susan and the two groups who have now taken sides, right? And you've got this thing going on. And what happens in the midst of that? You ever been there? Man, I've been there way too many times, right? What happens? I'll tell you what happens. Nothing happens because all the energy and focus gets poured into this disagreement, and no longer are we able to carry out the mission God's got for us. We're no longer to be who God wants us to be because we're all wrapped up in this disagreement and we've lost unity. And listen, the enemy loves disunity because he knows if you can get you focused on that crap, you'll never do what Jesus wants you to do. Amen? That's what happens. That's what takes place. And so Paul's saying, hey, we got to deal with this. But I want you to notice what Paul says about it. Paul's like, hey, ladies, you need to kind of get this taken care of. No, Paul operates out of fatherly authority. What's he say? I don't know what got your panties all wadded, but here's the deal. You need to get over it. You need to find a solution, right? You need to overcome this. And he writes and says to my trusted companion, he's talking to the pastor there. We don't know for sure who it was. He said, hey, you need to get involved, but here's the deal. You need to get over it. Because this is not about you and your thing and what you like or don't like. This is about the Lord and what he's got planned. See, this thing isn't about you or what you want or what you like. It's about Jesus and what God's doing and his kingdom and what he wants to manifest. And we have to deal with those things. We can't let, Paul said, don't let that stuff fester. Because he said it'll be a mess. And then what's he say? He says to the spiritual authority in the life of the church, deal with this. Come on, we were talking about it the other night in men's group. If there's not spiritual authority that is honored and respected in the life of the church, that kind of junk will go on because spiritual fathers step in and say, you know what, that's not who we are. We're not beating people up. We're simply saying, you know what, this is not who God created us to be. We got to resolve this. We got to do whatever we need to do to get past this because what? We got way more important things to be focused on. Amen? And without spiritual fathers, without spiritual authority in the life of the church, we just all look the other way and let it go. Come on, it's your house, dads, fathers, real fathers. If something's going on in your household, you better be saying something. Amen? That's why God put you there, right? To operate in His love and by His Spirit and His authority that He's given us to deal with those things. And Paul says, hey, we got to deal with this. And I understand that we have to let that. And so I love this. You know, the great theologian Barney Fife. What'd he say? Nip it in the bud, right? Right, we got to deal with those things. And that's not just me, that's all of us. Amen? And that's not just in here, in this family, it's in our families. We've got to deal with those things. So number one, we have to be diligent to maintain, to seek after unity among sons and daughters of the King. Amen? Number two, standing firm, is this. Be anxious for nothing. Uh-oh. Be anxious for nothing. Verse 4, Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. We quote that part of the verse, passage all the time. Verse 4, we wear it out, but we don't wear out the rest of it. But let your gentle spirit be known to all men. The Lord is near. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Paul's like, be anxious for nothing. Be worried about nothing. Be fearful for nothing. Why? Because what's the first thing that happens when you begin to be worried and have anxiety and fear? What happens? You panic. Amen? That's what anxiety is. It's really a fancy term for panic in our lives. You know how it is. You got the rents due or the house payments due, and you get your check on Friday and you realize you're $250 short. And what's going to happen? All of a sudden, you go into worry mode, right? Because if I don't pay it in full this time, they're getting a notice in the mail that they're going to send me a letter. They're going to start calling me. They're going to start wanting their money. And what am I going to do? And we get in panic mode. Oh, Lord, you got to do something. Oh, Lord, you got to do this. This could be terrible. Anybody know that kind of feeling? Anybody know that anxiety? Well, wait a minute. Paul says be anxious for a few things. Big stuff, We can be anxious and worried about what the doctor's report, right? It's okay to do that or maybe the financial issues or the medical test or my kids or my spouse. Let's be anxious about that. Don't be anxious for any of it, right? None of it. Don't be anxious for absolutely nothing. And in everything. I don't know. That seems pretty inclusive. You say, well, Pastor, you don't know what I'm going through. All I know is the Word says, in everything, be anxious for absolutely nothing. And then he gives us what? He says, in everything, what? By prayer. Now, that word prayer is the Greek word proshokomai. And the first part of that word, pros, means to come towards, to come near, face to face. In John 1, when it says that the Word was with God, and that word with is the word pros, that Jesus just wasn't with God, He was face to face with God. He says that the word prayer means to draw near, to come face to face to the Lord, and express your desire and communicate your need. Now, I want you to understand, when we talk about prayer, the majority of people, here's how we pray, right? Lord, we get loud, right? Because He needs to hear us, right? Because he's way up there in heaven, right? He's way up there, and so, oh, Lord, especially when we're anxious and we're worried, right? Oh, Lord, we get a little louder. We cry out, right? We talk about we got to cry out. We got to have a loud prayer meeting. Now, that's not what the word means. The word means face to face. So what's prayer look like? Prayer starts with, I get I sat down because he seated. Amen. Listen, Jesus isn't anxious about your thing. Just because you're anxious, Jesus isn't like, oh man, what are we going to do now? He's not anxious. He's seated. He's seated at the right hand. He's seated. And so what? We sat down face to face, and I do what? I begin to share with him what it is that I'm anxious about, what it is that I'm worried about. Why? Because he didn't know? No. It's because I need to share that with him. Why? Because when I take something that I'm worried about and I bring it to someone I know deeply loves me, there is a relief that comes in our spirit. Amen? You know, I need to sit down. And so what happens? Think about that in the natural. You know, let's say that, I'm going to pick on somebody, Emily. Emily comes to her dad, and there's something going on in her life, and she's worried and concerned about it, but she knows her dad dearly, deeply loves her and would withhold nothing from her. And she says, Dad, I want you to know this is what's going on. Dad probably already knows. But what happens? Suddenly there's a relief because I'm not carrying that by myself. Now I brought him into the loop. Now here's the thing. We want to bring a lot of other people in the loop. We get a bad medical report, we want to get the doctor in the loop and, you know, the medicine in the loop and lots of other stuff. Paul said, first, step one, get face to face and share with him what it is that you're dealing with. What an incredible picture. Matthew 11, I love that picture, and, you know, most of us know it, you know, in a more traditional sense, but I love this wording. Watch this, says, are you weary, carrying a heavy burden? Worry, anxiety, come to me and I will refresh your life, for I am your oasis. Man, I love that picture. Amen? See, the picture is what? Here I am laboring in the wilderness, right? It's hot, it's dry, I'm struggling, and then all of a sudden there's an oasis. What's an oasis? In the wilderness, an oasis is a place where there is trees and shade and grass and water, and you come into the oasis and it's like there's refreshment. It's this place of, and Jesus said, hey, if you're weary and heavy laden, if these things are laying on you, here's what I want you to do. I want you to be refreshed. Come to me. Verse 29, simply join your life with mine. Learn my ways and you'll discover I'm gentle and humble, easy to please, and you will find refreshment and rest in me. Why do I need prashokama? Why do I need to get face to face and share with him? Because when that happens, it becomes like an oasis. I begin to take that and I lay that on him, and what happens? I know he so loves me that he's not going to reject me. See, that's the problem. Most of us, if not all of us, we get face to face with Jesus and we're like, I'm not sure I should even be here, let alone that I'm going to talk to him. Why? Because we're not convinced how much he loves us yet. Well, he saved me, but I'm not sure he really wants to hang out with me like that. And that's the picture. We talk about coming boldly in the throne room. Most people think him high and lifted up on the throne and us down here on our faces before him. Not a bad picture, but that's not prashukama. Coming into the throne room face to face before him. Paul says, in everything by prayer. So let me ask you a question. Who here's got some anxiety or worry this morning? Come on, you can be honest in church, amen? Anybody got any of that? I see some heads shaking, right? Come on. Okay, so what are we going to do about that? See, I get tired of just people we just preach and never figure out what to do with it, right? So what happens? I've got this worry, and so what are we going to do? Well, here's what you're going to do. You're going to get before Jesus, and you're going to begin to talk to him about that thing. And he says what? I'm going to roll this on. And the reality is, if you've got that level of worry in us, I tell you what, you know, there's lots of things we can worry about. But when you begin to get here, When you begin to look into his eyes, when you begin, listen, the worry and the anxiety begins to roll away. And it starts by being in his presence. And so we start there. So Paul says, number one, right, by prayer. And then he says supplication. Now, that word supplication is two Greek words. It means to be in want or lack in a specific heartfelt request. And so here I am. I come before the Lord. I come before him with prayer and supplication. Now, so supplication is really the what? I keep the conversation going. See, it's not I just hit it. You know, hey, Lord, I got this concern and this worry. I give it to you now. Now, it's this supplication is this idea that I keep the conversation going. So let me use an example. Let's say that your daughter or son, but we'll pick daughter in this case, they come to dad, all right? And you're sitting in your lounge chair in the living room. They come up to you and say, Dad, I need some money in order to put some gas in my car because I don't have enough gas for the rest of the week. And I have this choir practice after school, and I need money to be able to drive to school and, you know, gas to get there and get back, and I just don't have enough money. I need some gas. Now, if you really are in need of some gas, you didn't text that in. You didn't, like, you know, what? You go into the living room, right, and you look at Dad, and you say, Dad, I've got this need. But then what happens? The supplication begins. Because an hour later, she comes back and she says, Dad, I just want you to know I'm going to need some gas money, face to face. An hour later, Dad, I'm going to need some gas money. Another hour goes by, Dad, bedtime, Dad. Next morning at breakfast, Dad, come on. Now, if she's just lobbing the request over there, that's one thing. But if she begins to have, what, face-to-face with Dad, guess what? Dad probably has some things to respond to that. Dad says, what happened to the allowance I gave you? Because there was money in that for gas for your car. Did you not have enough allowance? And all of a sudden, she begins to get a different perspective on her situation. What happens? Well, Dad, I need to download the latest, you know, Taylor Swift album. And I didn't have enough money on my debit card, so I had to take some of my allowance and put it in the bank so I would have money on my debit card so I could download the new music from Taylor Swift. And now I don't have enough for gas. And all of a sudden, the conversation changes because in the process of supplication, she now begins to see the issue from her father's perspective, not just hers. And friends, when you and I have this ongoing conversation with the Lord, prayer and supplication, we begin to get the perspective of the Father, not our perspective. And when we gain his perspective, it changes our request. Amen? We now begin to come in line, and now my daughter says what? Dad, I realized I had what I needed. You provided more than I really needed, but I chose poorly. And Lord, and Dad, now I am in need. Wow, that's a totally different conversation now than before, right? Prayer and supplication. Now, prayer, supplication, here's the last part, thanksgiving, right? And that's the part everybody really struggles with because they're like, whoa, what am I supposed to be thankful for? I got this real problem. I'm worried. I'm anxious. You know, think about it. People will say, well, here's what we need to be thankful. Be thankful for everything else you got. Okay, that's a great way to do it, right? We can be thankful, but here's what I want to suggest Paul's really saying. I want to suggest Paul's saying, start thanking him for that which he's already done that you haven't received yet. Come on. What's the scripture say? That we are to pray and believe we've already received it? See, if that's my attitude, I come and I already believe, I've asked, I've made, you know, I've had the conversation, I've sat down face to face, and I know that my Father loves me so much, what? That He's not going to withhold anything from me, that when I'm in alignment with Him, guess what? He's already going to do it. And now I'm thankful. Oh, Lord, thank you. I can't see it yet, but it's coming, baby. Oh, come on. Somebody ought to say amen. See, that's a whole different story. People ask me about my heart. I say, I don't know what's going on there, but the Lord's healing me. It's already done. I'm not concerned about whether I'm going to be around or not. Why? He's healing my heart. How do you know? I can't see it, but I know the Father. I know the one who loves me beyond compare. He's not going to withhold anything from me except His very best. And so what? My heart's being healed. Amen. Amen? People say, well, you're doing an awful lot of stuff. That's why, because I don't know what's going on in there, but man, it's working good. Everything's feeling good. Not, oh man, I wonder what's going to happen. Oh man, next week I wonder what will happen. Not worry, not anxiety. My brother, about a month ago, he said to me, he said, well, did you get to that point where you're mad at God? I said, nope. Never once. I'm like, you know what, Lord? Yeah. Well, his point was what? Well, because part of your life's being stolen away. You know what? My life's not been stolen. It's just been, there's been a curve in the road. And the reality is, I don't know what exactly He's got planned for me, but I know it's going to happen. Amen? It's going to be fulfilled in all the things He's declared and all the things He said. They're going to happen. Why? Because I'm not worried and anxious about what's going to happen in me. Brenda and I can talk about what? The future. And understand, neither one of us are anxious about what's going to happen. Why? Because we know the Father's love. He loves me the same way that He loves Jesus. Think about that. How many of you think that if Jesus asked for something, the Father would give it to Him? Amen? If the Father loves you the same way He loves Jesus, then why do we think He wouldn't do the same thing for us? Come on now. Come on. It hurts a little when we think about those things, right? Because we all been in the boat where I'm not sure He would do that for me. That's not what the Scripture says. We got to learn how much He really loves us, how much He cares about us. Amen. Don't be anxious for anything, but by prayer, what? Supplication and thanksgiving, bring it before the Lord. And then watch verse 7. You ready for this? And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your heart and your minds in Christ Jesus. Wait a minute. The peace of God. It doesn't say you would have the peace of God. No. It says the peace of God will guard your heart and your minds. Where's worry and anxiety come from? Your heart and your mind, right? Come on, how many of us, we get to thinking about stuff? Come on, Jay, you're shaking your head. You're sitting in that chair at home thinking about stuff, right? Gail, you're sitting there thinking about stuff. I tell you what, in the last few months, man, I was one of those sitting in the chair and thinking about stuff. He says, no. If what? You bring everything by prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, he says, then the peace of God will protect your heart and your mind from the worry and the anxiety and the concern that desires to dominate you. How? Because you know His love is so deep for you, you've got nothing to worry about. Come on. Bible says we should become like little children, have faith like little children. We had Clark yesterday, all day. Grandma Brenda was in heaven yesterday. Had him all day long for like 12 hours. You know what? Clark's 8 months old. He just has absolute faith in Grandma, right? Me and him played, but then, I need a bottle, Grandma's going to put one in my mouth. I need a diaper change, Grandma's going to take care of that. I need some green beans in my face and some pears, got that taken care of. I need a different toy because I'm bored, Grandma's got it taken care of. Why? Because he just believes. He just trusts. And that's what God's saying to us. That's what Paul's saying. Man, we get to that point where we're so loved by the Father. It's just like, My heart's protected. I have the peace guarding my heart and my mind. So number one, if we want to stand firm, we've got to maintain unity. Number two, be anxious for nothing. But here's the third one, focus on the good stuff. Man, I love that one, right? Finally, brethren, whatever is true and whatever is honorable and whatever is right and whatever is pure and whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellent and if anything worthy of praise, dwell on those things. Woo! Man, that's a good word right there. Come on. So what's that mean? That means that we have to take, if we want to stand firm in the things of the Lord, we have to look at what He's doing and the good stuff that's taking place and get our eyes constantly off all the stuff, you know, that we say is falling apart. Come on, the church helps us. Oh, the world's going to hell in a handbasket. It's just getting worse all the time. Come on. CNN. Turn off NBC, MSNBC. Turn off Fox News. Come on, some of you are like, I can't. No, turn off Fox News. Why? Because all they're going to tell you is how awful things are. Right? Paul says, hey, here's the thing. We got to get our minds focused in on that which God is doing and the good things that's happening. Right? We got to find those places and those things and celebrate those and rejoice in those. Man, I tell you what, we haven't talked about it in a while, but man, Nay's doing awesome, amen? Praise the Lord, going back to the end of the month for another evaluation, and praise the Lord, you know, hopefully one of these days she'll come agree with Gail to come to church, and man, we'll have a celebration that day, amen? What? Man, we got to celebrate that, amen? We got to focus on what God's doing. We got to focus on what He's doing, the good things He's doing, the doors He's opening, the opportunities He's given, and not get so drawn to, oh, there's another drug dealer in town. Well, probably is. You know what? But we're not going to get all wore out about that. I'm not going to be all worried about that. What? We're simply going to say, Lord, You know what's going on here, and Lord, You know, use us to what? To bring about a resolution. Lord, our community. We're not going to get all worked up about it. Amen? He says, here's the thing I want you to do. I want you to think on the good stuff. And here's the deal. We need one another. He created a family so we can encourage one another by pointing out the good stuff. Come on, Wanda. Sometimes we just need somebody pointing out the good stuff, right? Because we forget. We tend to forget. And we need to encourage one another. Say, hey, what about this? And how good is God here? And what's He done? And how blessed are you? How incredible are you? I tell you what, Brenda and I, you know, we bought this house at auction, and you know, the Lord opened the door for that, and you know, the paperwork has just been like, you know, it's like the first house we got. You know, it's just, in fact, hopefully we'll close in about 10 days. We'll be done, we'll be in. You know, incredible things are going on there. Woo! Thank you, Jesus, right? Look at the good stuff. We could focus on some bad stuff, but let's focus on the good stuff. And Paul says, we got to maintain unity. We got to be anxious for nothing. We got to look at the good stuff. And then what's the last one? You see it there in the text? The last one says this, that we are to what? Somebody help me. Practice. What? Practice what we know. Look what the text says. The things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Pros. That word we're with is pros. With you. We'll be with you right here. Face to face with you. Why? What's he saying? Here's the thing. The things that we have learned and the things we know, simply practice them. And I love that word practice. Because that doesn't mean I got it all perfectly right. I'm just going to seek to do what we know. I tell you what, I've run with people, you know, in the past who all they want to know is something new, something new, something new. And the Lord's like, why don't we do what we already know? Wouldn't that be good? Paul says, if you want to stand firm, take what God's already spoken into you and just walk in it. Oh, come on, that's a novel idea, right? Just take what I know and operate in it, function in it, seek to live it out. And then He'll reveal some more stuff and we'll live out of that. Amen? Take what we know. See, Paul wants you and I standing firm. What? Not just in our faith, standing firm in the journey of becoming more and more transformed in the image of Him. more and more into oneness with Him. And here's the thing. If we get sidetracked in any of those four areas, what happens? Our focus comes off of Him and becomes over here on something else. Let me tell you, friends, He wants you to be free. He wants you free to live out. See, here's what I know this morning. And I don't know any specific situation, but here's what I know. A group of 40 or 45 people like this, there are people right now that there's a lack of unity in some part of your life. There's a lack of unity somewhere. Somewhere that unity's lacking, and guess what? It's causing what? Distraction. It's causing us not to be able to fully focus on what God has for our lives, for our families, for our church. I hope that's not true within this family we call Prairie Grove. If it is, we just need to deal with it. Or maybe this morning you're here and you're anxious or you're worried. You're all worked up. You're fretting over something. God, Jesus doesn't want you to do that. Doesn't want that to be true. He says, hey, by prayer and supplication, let the peace and thanksgiving, let the peace of God protect your heart. Maybe you're all wrapped up in the stuff that's going wrong instead of the stuff that God's doing that's right. And maybe, Holy Spirit's been speaking into your heart and your life, and He says, here's the road I have for you. Here's what the next step is for you. And you just haven't yet decided to do what you know, to be who you know to be. See, He wants us to be free to walk in the fullness of who He desires for us to be. And so this morning, I don't want you leaving here unfree. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to worship a little bit. And I just want you, if that's you, if one of those things or multiple of those things, I want you just to allow the Lord to bring about an adjustment in that thing, to bring healing in that thing, to bring restoration, whatever needs to happen, so that no longer we're not carrying that anymore, and His peace is released upon us. Amen? Well, Father, we just thank You for Your word. Lord, we want to stand firm, not in our faith, not upon some standard that we've created, but to stand firm in this journey You have called us to, into the abundant life that You desire for us. And so, Lord, this morning we just ask You, Holy Spirit, we welcome You to speak to our hearts. Minister to us. Set us free. And Lord, however You lead us, maybe we need to leave it here today on the altar. Maybe we just need You to touch our hearts. Maybe You renew our minds. Whatever it might be today, Holy Spirit, we give You permission now to move and to work in a powerful way. Amen. Holy Spirit, come fall on us. And oh Lord, as we go forth from this place today, Holy Spirit, well up in us, would you lead us? And Lord, as we celebrate Independence Day this week in this country, may we walk in new freedom today for the glory of your name. And all God's people said, amen. Hey, you all have a great week. We'll see you next week.